morning, everybody. I'm sure I'm audible, loud and clear, right? Everything fine?
Yes.
Great, great. I'm Colonel Prabir, Sengupta, which is Seva Medal. I've put in 25 years in the Indian Army. While in the Indian Army, I was also instructed in Indian Military Academy. Subsequently, I held various posts till I was commanding an infantry battalion in combating terrorists. For the kind of work we did, my unit did, we were recommended.
Army.
Besides these natural disasters, we have of course had some man-made disasters. The man-made disasters, like when you go down to the timber trail, October 92, when 10 holiday makers were hanging 5,000 feet above the ground when the cable snapped and they were looking forward for succor. Major Evan Castro of one para regiment, flown in by leader Air Chief Marshal Major, Fali Major, rescued this operation, these tourist makers. Of course, then you had your five-year-old prince falling down a 60-foot well, and you all are very familiar with these photographs. Sometimes it was for national image that we reacted when the French fell, when we were having our Asian Games, and very recently, of course, we had the Elphinstone Road bridge, which collapsed, and Indian Army made the bridge in 6 months. Any number of times, you would have seen the Indian Army working beyond its call of duty. Any number of times, be it the surgical strikes in Uri or the 26/11 in Mumbai, Indian Army has always covered itself with glory. And people kept asking me, at a number of times you would have seen, it is not a question of who will do it, unlike the industry. Here it is always, when will it get done? That differentiates us from the city street. We don't look for volunteers, everyone is volunteer. And that kind of intrinsic motivator motivates us to get things done. The awards, rewards, recognition paradigm in the army is totally different from how it incentivizes the people in the city street. We don't have ESOPs, we don't have promotions, we don't have bonuses. We can't increase a single penny of his pay. How do we motivate these people to perform? Our rewards and recognition, therefore, are not based on if-then reward. If you do this, if you meet this target, if you meet this sales number, you get this reward. You get this bonus. These are extrinsic motivators. External motivators will not motivate you. We look for, now that you have captured Tiger Hill, you will may be recognized. So we don't do it for recognition. Recognition comes, follows as an outcome of what we do. And therefore, you would have had n number of instances of individual bravery much beyond the call of duty, be it Lieutenant Colonel Hoshiar Singh, be it Major Dyan on Hajipir Pass, or be it Shaitan Singh, who was responsible to save Srinagar that day. Or it could be as young as Vikram Batra, or Lieutenant Khetrapal, or even Subedar Bana Singh. These people have gone beyond their call of duty. They laid down their lives to protect the nation. We consider ourselves as the last bastion of this nation. And therefore, the motto itself of the Indian Army says, service before self. And that distinguishes us into what we do. Number of people, when I was told to address this, was to tell me to address it in a situation where valor comes in and you take decisions. Believe me, these decisions are not easy. Do we face VUCA? Imagine each time I'm encountering a terrorist, it's a VUCA situation. It's a different enemy, it's a different environment, it's a different mindset, it's a different strategy he's adopting. Each and every time there's ambiguity, there's complexity, and there is confusion. Each time is a different engagement. I'll give you a stage that was set in somewhere in the northern sector. Early morning, at around 4:30, this girl walks up to our gate in our camp and tells us, sir, there were 4 terrorists in our village, whole night, who have abused us. We want recrimination. We want them dead. We react. And my next, and they have left northwest. I can't show you the maps here. They have left northwest. My next post, which is between this and that location, is roughly 10 kilometers. what are the chances that I'll encounter these four terrorists who have left after a night of abuse? Just to give an idea, this is the kind of terrain I'm talking of. On the right extreme, you'll see a bird's eye view of how the terrain looks like. On the bottom left and the top left, you'll see how, when you go near, how the terrain looks like. And if you see these huge boulders on the left bottom, you see that they are protected. If I throw a grenade there, it doesn't impact them because they are hiding behind this grenade. And in this 10 kilometers, imagine how do I find these four terrorists. Of course, we do have, and there are a number of places where they can go, hide, or take refuge. But what do? We analyze the situation, we take the environment, we take the terrain, and we say, these are the places, spots where they could be. One of them was a water point where we knew from history that the handler would come there, pick them up, they would lift up their army there, and guide them. We said, first, hit the water point. We go to the water point, and fortunately for us, we are fired at. How many people consider that as fortunate? We do. Because if there is no fire, dal achhe. If there is no fire, there is no enemy. And if they are not firing, that means they could be friendly forces. We look for fire. And once the bullet was fired, we said, yeah, now is the time we can. And then we do our probing firing and we encircle them. Now the challenge I pose to you as the decision dilemma. The first, of course, is where and how do you make your contact? The second decision is, should you open fire? Meaning, now imagine a situation where you've got these four terrorists in the terrain that I've shown you, encircled, and should they run behind back to the country from where they came from, I don't want them to escape. So I place troops there. I'm here, I'm there, I'm all across surrounding him. If I fire, I'm firing into my old men. How do I fire? How do I utilize these elements? The major decision dilemma. Right? So we call our Ghatak platoon. Ghataks are the commandos of our team. We tell them, probe. Meaning, I'm telling him to give, lay down his life. Because when he's probing, he's crawling and moving next to those boulders to see where are they hidden and can we engage them. The brave hearts crawl. Go, and in a distance of roughly 3 meters, 4 meters, see them, and they're fired at. And then they fire back. In an operation which lasts roughly 4 hours, we neutralize this for terrorists. Decision dilemma. People keep saying, how do we evict this terrorist? It is not easy. Especially when you are being fired at, and these are live bullets. We go ahead and we do this. I'll give you another example of valor. Here we had gotten information that there was this house in the Dhok, we call them Dhok, in the mountain top, where we suspect the terrorists come, dump their weapons, and then freely walk around without the weapons. And if you don't have a weapon, you're not a terrorist. Right? Your name is not there. Of course, we have the documents to prove and all. But without a weapon, it becomes a greater challenge to neutralize this terrorist. And here was this door where we got this information that they came there. So we go there. Now my question to you all is, the decision dilemma that we talk of, right? Information, authenticity. Now imagine a khabri comes and tells you that there is this. You are not sure whether he's double agent and he's taking you there to be ambushed. Secondly, what is the authenticity of this kind of information? So we go there. We look around for these weapons. Of course, they are not there. You will never find them. Because there are n number of places where they can be hidden across the field. You have just seen the photograph. All across, there are those fields, there are mountains, there. It could be dumped anywhere. And each operation, we don't carry your, you know, metal detectors. You don't. You're traveling like that, when you're walking for 4 to 5 hours on mountaintop, you're not carrying those heavy equipment. Now, how do we And that is the time when we work on something called, do you work on your intuition, your gut feel? And here was the second lieutenant in my unit who said, sir, I have a sense, I have a premonition, it is here. I said, fine, go ahead, let's see. And you can't break down their house, right? Think of your house and someone comes and breaks it. You can't do that. And I said, Prabir, how will you get these weapons out? Where are they? He said, sir, let me just. And he sits there thinking for 10 minutes. And he says, sir, I found it. And I was looking at him, what? Where did you find it? He says, sir, did you notice the house? I said, yes, there it is. He says, did you measure the distance of the house? It worked out to some 24 feet. He says, sir, under kamra kitna chota hai? How small is the room inside? I said, very small. He says, sir, there is a double ceiling here. And rightfully, when we broke one wall, behind that wall was dumped. They were all meshed up in this wall. Weapons which we otherwise were being, these were the weapons that would have been used against your Indian forces. All hidden in a false wall. Now, how do you get to identify something? So how long or when would you trust your instinct or your gut feeling? Even in civil speech, you come across such situations. Every time it may not work. Experience and training does help you to own this gut feeling. The more you work on a certain thing, you will know for sure how it works. He says 24 feet, sir. Inside 20 feet, there's a 4 feet gap. There's some dissonance here. And we hit upon these weapons. Each and every time you go out for operations, you are not sure what will be the outcome. And therefore, I was very, very, very happy when my battalion got recognized and we were moved to Rashtrapati Bhavan. The photograph that you see is the first day of our unit taking over the duties at Rashtrapati Bhavan. I was privileged to have served the late President Kalam for a year and a half in this building. And yours truly, of course, was awarded with the vicious development by the President himself. People said, why do you do what you do? Sankhi hokya? Are you mad? Why does the Indian Army, infantry predominantly, do the kind of thing they do? And I tried to find an answer to this madness. And I think I came down with an answer when we say something called Naam, Nama, and Nishana. It's the name of my battalion that I am ready to sacrifice my life. It's the Namak of this country, Desh, that we are ready to die. And the Nishan is a standard which you carry to battle, around which the forces rally and protect it. It is related to your Naam. And these three things are our guiding principles when we go into battle. Naam, Nam, Nishan. A lot of people, we have our fair share of failures. We have n number of failures when we have to shoulder the martyrs on our and take and accompany these martyrs to their hometowns. It's not a good feeling, I assure you. And we see that very, very closely. Of course, we have our fair share of successes as well when we are engaged with these terrorists. And some person then rightfully said, it is not what we do. It is that we are helping them organize their meet with their maker earlier. Lot of times, people then ask, besides your Naam, Namak, Nishan, how do you go about doing things? For a young officer, young person, the youth of our country, I would say, it is a sense of duty. Your commitment to the cause, bounded with discipline, and your pride in the organization. Jis thali mein khare, usme chhed nahi kar sakte. The day you are engaged with an organization, you can't belittle it. Be it your motherland. Of course, there are problems. But you and me together can solve these problems.
by deriding it, by belittling it, you're only belittling yourself. Rightly, Arun mentioned, these are problems which our intelligent minds can solve once we address it. It is not something which is not doable. Right, therefore, if I wanted to give some takeaways, if you're a leader, first and foremost would be integrity beyond reproach. Your moral turpitude cannot be questioned, ever. Ever. Second, your foresight and vision to see what is coming. The very city that we are standing in today is a perfect example of what is foresight and what is vision. Next, take calculated risk. She was mentioning in her talk, take calculated risk. Unless you take calculated risk, you will not come out of your comfort zone. Push yourself, push the envelope. And last but not the least is nishkam kar. Do your job. That is why you are here. Do your job. If you are looking for the rewards, recognition, believe me, they will follow. And each one of you who is sitting here knows you will invariably get more than what you deserve. Look back on your life and you would have realized, yes, I have got something more than what I really deserve. I have worked hard, but the results have invariably been more than what I deserve. If you are a team member, of course, team work is the bedrock. Winners always hunt in packs. The sum total of the whole is greater than the sum total of the parts. Invariably, always and every time. And have explicit faith in your buddy. Because this buddy is the reason why I am standing today in front of you. Because he was responsible to look after one half while I was looking after the other half. The buddy pairs together. I need to have explicit faith on this buddy. And therefore in the army we used to say, he is my brother. Because should something happen in operations, my own blood brother would not have been there to light my fire. It would have been my buddy. Have that kind of faith in the system. Last, nishkam kar. Keep doing your job. Keep doing your job. And as individual, I would suggest, have a sense of discipline of your mind, of your body. It pains me to see people, youth, frittering away the kind of energy that they have been blessed with. And the great, great, great things that you are rightfully supposed to achieve. Train, train, and train some more. Only with training will you be able to excel and achieve what you have set out for. Have that kind of self-belief. Yes, I can. Yes, I can. I can do it. This self-belief is also correlated with your self-efficacy and your training. And that belief strengthens. And last but not the least of it is nishkam karma. Chapter 2, verse 7 of Bhagavad Gita says, Jai Kundanandan, ek vyavsay atmika buddhi eka. Your vyavsay as a student, atmika, your wisdom, buddhi, your intellect, eka. That kind of focus, there is no reason why there will be no success. You are bound to succeed. With this kind of focus, vyavsay, atmika, buddhi, eka, I am sure each one of you here will excel. Thank you so much. It was such a pleasure.